It's breathtaking.
When you see sand here, imagine water. If you dive in, you can't reach the bottom.
You dive in?
Yes, it's called swimming.
I don't believe you.
In the shadows of Arrakis lie many secrets. But the darkest of them all may remain. The end of House Atreides.
Your father didn't believe in revenge.
What if Paul Atreides were still alive?
Have you ever had a dream about your first ride?
Don't try to impress anyone. You're brave, we all know that. Be simple. Be direct. Nothing fancy.
I understand. Nothing fancy.
You will never lose me, Paul Atreides.
We gave them something to hope for.
That's not hope!
May thy knife chip and shatter.
Have you seen it yet? Well, if you haven't, it's not our fault. Because if you're watching us talk about this movie tonight, there will be spoilers. You've been warned. We're going to take you on the Ark. Welcome. So have you seen it? Have you seen the movie? Because we're going to be in trouble if we haven't both seen this movie.
I have seen the movie.
Oh, good. Good.
Yes, I've seen part one about 50 times.
How?
I just saw part two last week.
How can you have seen part one so many times? It's like wrenching. How did you survive watching it more than once?
Exaggerating slightly. I did see it once, maybe.
Oh, my gosh.
I liked it a lot. I liked it
Why?
A lot.
Why did you like it so much?
I think film, when you go to a theater, should be. I just recently learned, because you told me, that the director said it had to be in theaters for at least 2 months. This was a movie that was huge scope and needed to be seen on a big screen for sure.
Yeah.
And I like that because it's a bit of fantasy. right? It's like you're going to another world and you can feel like kind of surrounded by it. Mm-hmm. And his vistas are so huge. And as some people have complained about, you know, the loudness of the soundtrack when you're, but I think it's actually fitting. Because everything is, you know, it's got big characters and, you know, big scenes and huge machines and big sandals.
Right. What's fun about doing this discussion tonight, it was the first one is the one that inspired us to write Draco Chemicus. Right. 2 years ago, it came out in the summer and we started talking about the spice, and I did those blog posts on the power of the spice and the importance of the spice. And then we started talking about, like, how does that, you know, addict people? And it's like, it's Dune mm-hmm. The deep backstory of what we're trying to write in our own poem. So yeah. Yes.
Yeah, it is. And I think we'll probably touch on this later, but it's very messianic, or is it? Right.
Well, that's indeed. Right. And this is so. OK, so you say you've seen the first movie multiple times. I've only seen it once in the theater. And I then after that, I rewatched the 1984 one, the David Lynch version, which is it has a few good bits in it. Right. But.
Yeah.
I think I must have seen that one when it came out in the theater, because I was in college at that point and I was hanging out with guys who read a lot of sci-fi. So we must have gone to see it in the theater. Because it would seem.
I think I saw it on HBO on the small screen.
Maybe. What's funny is it's like Dune has this. I mean, just the music and the landscape and everything like that. It's incredibly fitting for something that for me in my life has been haunting in the background. Things that, unlike Tolkien, which I've been, you know, like reincorporating on a very purposeful level for, you know, decades now, and have thought through a lot. Dune sort of until last 2 summers ago just hung out in the background of this thing I remembered kind of, but not really.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. What I remember of the first one is everyone who had read the book was severely disappointed in the way it looked.
Really?
And said because I distinctly remember them saying this, because this is the same problem The Lord of the Rings, had when they tried to put it on screen. Mm. Whoever did the first one in 1984 tried to compress what should have been a multi-movie story into one movie, and it showed. Mm-hmm. People were severely disappointed. They had some of the big scenes in it that are the same ones that are in part two that we just saw last week. But it was missing a lot more detail. And I must think that I just started reading it myself. I've never read the book. It's very easy to read, but there's a lot of detail packed into those pages that are easy to read. I can see why it was so popular.
Right.
And I think The Lord of the Rings has, of course, way more detail. The man created a new language and maps and worlds, multiple time periods. And you can't compress that into a 2-hour movie either.
Right.
And I remember Christopher Tolkien being very disappointed in it, because he said they turned it into an action movie. It's not an action movie.
The Lord of the Rings.
Lord of the Rings, correct. And I think Peter Jackson did that because it's a visual medium. You have to show something.
Right.
Right. And I think Villeneuve, and I can't remember who, was it David Lynch did the 1984 one?
David Lynch did the 1984 one. Yeah,
I think what they were trying to do was the same thing. They had to put some action on the screen. He did that very well Villeneuve did that very well in part one. Part two, well, we can discuss that. I think
we'll get to that. We're warming you all up right now.
Slower,
right?
Yeah.
Well, but so what's interesting about Dune I have a new copy because let's see, the old copy I had, which I don't think is mine, split in half. Right?
Well used.
But the thing is, this one, it's an American edition. I was thinking it was my husband's, but it was, it's a 25th century. 25th anniversary edition, September 1990, which means it can't be the one that I read in high school, right? But I do have, I always like, this is my cred, right? I got Sting, not the Sting that was in the David Lynch movie.
Yeah, I was just thinking that. Yeah.
So I do my Tolkien cred. These are the copies I had of Dune Messiah and Children of Dune from high school, and I know that I had them in high school, and I also know it's funny you're saying that it was easy to read. I found it incredibly difficult to read in high school. I was mystified beyond.
Oh well, I'm on page 18. So,
well, I was confused from the beginning. Right? It's like you it opens.
Well, no. But I saw the movie, so that very first scene in the book was very prominent in the movie in part one. So
yeah, this is just the one book, and then I can't remember whether I read the rest of them. God Emperor, so Dune Messiah, Children of Dune, God Emperor of Dune, Heretics of Dune, Chapter House Dune. I kind of know those titles. I know I have two of those books. I don't know whether I read the rest of it. So and then he kept going, and then his son and a co-author did a whole other series, right? So it's like there's a...
Yep.
Just admitting this here, I have no clue what's in the rest of it.
I actually looked at spoilers for the sequels to Dune. Yeah. And I will say only this one thing about it. I sincerely hope Villeneuve makes a part three and that he changes what was original. Because, anyway...
Well, in any case, therefore we are approaching our conversation tonight as novices rather than as you know, multiple rereads like I do with Tolkien. And I you know, it's like that what you said, like people are upset about the people who know the book really well are upset about what's going on in the movies. And I do know the first book well enough from having reread it 2 years ago to be upset about some of the stuff in the movies, but I'm not sure that's the best way to think about what Villeneuve has done in the movies. On the other hand, the other hand, I do want to point to some of the very significant way he changed the ending, everybody. Spoiler alert. Because I do think it is going to create more problems for him than possibilities. But I want to think about like, we had to do this stream because like literally everybody is asking me, or at least three people, are you going to talk about Dune? And I'm like, okie dokie. And my husband had really wanted to see the second part with me. We went on Saturday. We both left upset. Yes, and you had really enjoyed it. So I was like, this is good. We left upset. You left happy. That's a starting place.
Well, I think now again, I did not read it, right? And you and your husband have both read it at least once.
So somebody's read some of these,
I can tell you, I think part two wasn't as good. The visuals were still incredibly stunning, you know, and I think you're gonna get to this later, but the scenes with Fade are amazing. That Austin Butler is
oh my gosh, how did I not know who Austin Butler was? I feel like finding Ken Gosling last summer. Not Ken Gosling, yeah, Ryan Gosling.
I had to look it up actually, as I was watching this, because he affected an accent that was matching Stellan Skarsgård's accent, which I thought was perfect because he's supposed to be his nephew. And that was fine. But when he did that, I actually thought it was one of Stellan Skarsgård's sons who also acts. And I can't remember his name. I wish I could. I can't remember his first name. I want to say Alexander, but that might not be it.
No names. We are fuzzy about all of this. We have warned you all. Do not judge. Well, you can judge us if you like, but we told you so, right? That's not our expertise tonight. Yeah. We have other layers that we're gonna play with here.
Many layers.
Well, it's a little like, you know, Ken with the Barbie movie, right? It's suddenly like Fade Routh. It's like it was Sting in the David Lynch movie. He was ridiculous. That metal, but
well,
that metal
was.
Like Speedo that he had on. Oh my gosh, that was so dumb. So, but on the other hand, my husband, who is actually English, hated that accent that Butler put on. So, your mileage may vary whether you, and this is, people are having, so one member of my family said there was no way he was going to go see the movie because he knew it was going to be, you know, like skin tight suits with Nehru collars and bad dialogue. And I'm like, oh, well, that's definitive. Oh.
Yeah.
And I will say this is one of the younger members of my family, not one of the ones my age. So,
oh, interesting.
So this is a movie worth talking about because it's one of those people are talking about it, right? What are they talking about? Why is it so powerful? And I do think it is, right? For the reasons that you were saying the first one was, the visual. I mean, I could just, I could just keep watching that trailer that we just saw and listen to the soundtrack. It's
incredible. It completely takes you out of wherever you are and puts you in that space. Right. And you can just kind of absorb like everything around you and just absorb the story. And it's the scope was so large, I mean, visually, that you could get lost, which is a wonderful thing that a good movie can do because it's an escape.
It's your drug. Admit it. It's your spice. No, it is. I went to the movie and said, I'm going to get the biggest pot of popcorn and now the local theater has put in like recliner chairs. We found that out when we see Barbie and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so comfortable, right? So you recline back, you got your popcorn, it's spice. And it is actually, I think, pretty important to recognize this, that when you are talking to someone about what movies you enjoy, you're sharing what drugs you like.
Oh, that's funny. I love adventure movies, but I'm not an adrenaline junkie at all. But I like that movie.
See? So it's like we go to them. I mean, never mind, you know, Brave New World and the Soma and stuff like that. We're doing it. The popcorn is the carbs for sure. And the sensory like surround that the modern theaters can have is immersive. We didn't see it in an IMAX. We just saw it in a regular tiny little screen thing, but since I barely go to movies now, that seemed big. You know, it would be amazing seeing it in IMAX, right? Because you'd just be.
I know. I'm probably going to do it by the end of the summer.
Right, and then consider you're talking about the scope of it, how big it feels landscape wise, but it's also incredibly intimate, right? That a lot of the I'm trying to find stills for tonight's discussion because it's still only in theaters, so the only thing you can capture offline is lots of clips from the trailers, that it's lots and lots and lots of close-ups.
There are lots of close-ups, and when they have the close-ups, they're still, I mean, the makeup and the clothes and the completely different culture you're just kind of instantaneously zapped into when you're watching this still makes it seem like kind of big and important, right? Like, yes, there are these intimate scenes, but the director's choice of costuming and sets was still really impressive, even when you had just two people talking to each other on a bunch of sand dunes. It mattered. It was his choices mattered.
So these are all, I would say thinking, before I went into the why it bugged me problems, right? The things that people are responding to and that you want to respond to, and that I think is therefore an answer to indeed the deeper layers to what Villeneuve was doing and what Herbert was playing at, and again why this is an incredibly important movie. But one that the music is the hauntingness of it is huge, is what you're describing, and that chant that's in the trailer, whatever it sounds like, it's that there's a feeling of the sacred somewhere in it.
Yeah,
for sure.
Well, it's a feeling of being like almost forcibly drawn in when you see it and hear it.
But that there's thinking my students who are asking me whether I'd seen it, and the sort of sense of, I watched, you know, we study up for these conversations, and I watched a few YouTube videos where people are talking about it, and ones that are liking are just saying, you know, it's so perfect, and it's so absorbing, and it's, this is going to be the best movie of my life, and something like that. I want to think about what people are responding to, and
it is absorbing. Yeah. That's a great word.
That it's, so the music is there, and then what we've already mentioned, this, the cinematography is incredibly calm. And what you were saying, you're not an adrenaline junkie. We didn't want it to be an action movie. It's not, I mean, there are fight scenes in it, which are interesting, but a lot of it is incredibly calm. If you think about the usual blockbuster stuff now, which I hate, I'm like, how long is this chasing going on? I'm bored now. Right. Because it's, you know, chop, 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 chop. This is all like long shots.
They can be tedious.
And close up and calm. It harks back to older video, older movie making.
Right. It does. And I noticed that when we were preparing.
In some ways. And then what you've already said, like the costumes, right? That there's, everybody's going to want to be like in flowy desert robes now.
I really am. Yeah. I don't think I can pull that off at my height, but
yeah. You can try.
I look like a pile of laundry.
Well, the people do. This is, unfortunately, when things started breaking for me, and I'm like, where do they get the clothes? What are they made out of? There's no plants. It's a little bit like the Lord of the Rings problem. It's like, where are all the people that make stuff?
Where are all the factories?
who makes those thumper things to call the worms? I mean, like, do they have injection mold plastic somewhere?
Well, I don't know. Suspend practicalities.
Well, okay. Raidline says, feels like the chanting monks in the Halo video games. That would be interesting. We do not have the expertise in a lot of these layers of the media to know exactly what Villeneuve is drawing off of. I feel like there's echoes of various things that we have pinpointed, but there must be other things too.
I think so too. I think he's got a wide breadth of influences that he draws from.
Yeah. So what do we think this movie's about? Okay, is it a love story? That's what I realized with the trailer that I found that I was able to download. There are a few others out there, but this one, it starts with Paul and Shani sitting on the dunes talking about, you know, saying it's water on my planet. You can swim in it.
Yeah, right? I love that because the two of them are essentially sitting on the bottom of the ocean that's been drained. Mm. So this is what it looks like when there's no water there. And when he's describing the water to her, I thought that was a really sweet scene. It was like, it's like a budding romance, budding romance. Right. But I wouldn't describe this as a love story.
Hmm. Okay. So that's one option, right? So, and love story, it is in the way in which it's being marketed. It's, you know, like it's Paul and Chani and those are the two young stars in it.
True.
That you therefore expect it to be a love story, particularly after the first one, right? When he's having dreams and seeing her before they meet.
Yes.
And so we should expect, we have the hope and the expectation that this could be a love story. All right. So maybe is it, I mean, the other thing that people are definitely responding to is Paul leading the battle, right? So he's there on the ledge, raising his knife and calling the Fremen into their first leg of their holy war.
Yeah, this is what I think is the most interesting thing about part two is he clearly rejects this, like, over and over again, rejects this idea that he's their Messiah.
Right.
And at the same time, he's pulled towards revenge and being encouraged and pushed to accept it because you can get these people following you and we can defeat them. And he's like, oh wow, in his head, you know, he's just thinking, yeah, this would be a great tool to do this. He's very conflicted. So it is about a leader. It's about a very conflicted leader. Okay. He's pulled between revenge and just wanting to do right by these people that he's come to love and that his father respected.
Right.
And he respected his father's ideas of treating people well and not using and abusing them the way that Harkonnen did for 80 years. He wanted to change that. I think it's possible. I didn't again. I haven't read the books. I think it's possible his father might have had ulterior motives, but he's presented because he wanted to defeat the Harkonnen. But he's presented as a reasonable mm-hmm. man, and he's accepted as a reasonable man. And Paul knows this, and he kind of, I think he's torn in multiple directions. I think the love story aspect is just a. I think it might have been a distraction in the trailers.
Okay, so it's a suggestion that it could be a love story, but maybe it's in fact a. I mean, another yeah. one. It's a coming yeah. of age story, right? It's that, Paul well, needs to grow up and turn into this leader, which is.
I think he did that in the part one. Yeah, well, I think yeah, the coming of age was part one. He was forced into adulthood immediately. He put on his father's ring. He's now the Duke. Right. And Duncan Idaho, you know, kneels before him.
But then he has to learn how to do that. So, I mean, this they'll invoke my husband's frustration with it. He's saying the actor wasn't actually convincing in this transformation. Yeah,
Timothy Chalamet.
Right. My husband and I both liked the first one a lot, and we would say, well, in fact, in the first one, it's his parents who were like carrying the drama. Because it's the relationship between Jessica and yes. his father, whose name I forgot.
Yeah.
The Baron. Leto. Oh, that's important. Okay, so it's Jessica and Leto, and they carry it, and all Paul has to do is be the kind of whiny kid in the background, not wanting to leave his planet. And so, yes, by the end, he has to recognize that his father is dead. He has to take care of his mother insofar as he can. But she's still kind of in charge at the end of... The first one, the first movie. So the actor had a different problem in the first movie than he has in the second, because in the second one, he actually has to turn into the war leader.
Yes. And yeah, he does start doing that. I think in part two, I think the turning point for him was when he saw their sacred pool destroyed. Mm. And then he got real angry and was like, okay, now it's war. I don't think that was explored enough, and I can see the problems with part two, why it would be so disappointing. I'm just guessing why it might be so disappointing to you and your husband and other people who have said that it wasn't great, is because that seemed like kind of an important development in Paul's character. And I don't think it was brushed over very quickly in favor of showing action battle scenes.
Right.
You get skipped way too fast over
but
that.
But it's the whole point of the series. Right?
It's his transformation.
The next,
right.
which one comes next? I think it's Dune Messiah, right? Yeah. Yeah. So the whole point is he becomes the Messiah. And the whole tension that the movie develops between Chani and him is over that, right? Over this role that he's taking on. So insofar as it's not a love story, because it kind of is, it's because of the role that he's taking on as the war leader and the revenge leader and the potential jihad commander.
Yes. Yeah. So I couldn't figure out whether she wanted him to do it or not. She clearly, Johnny? She doesn't want to fight.
Yeah.
Johnny. Yeah. She wants to fight them, but she doesn't want to fight under his leadership. Because she thinks it's all superstition.
Oh, well, okay, so that's the next layer, right? So we have here his mom in her full kit with a veil, right? It's like, we got to get these veils, right? And face tattoos and her other ladies, mm-hmm. The other ladies behind her in hijab. So saying a lot here about like the larger frame of the story. It's the love story is not just happening in the frame of the coming of age story, but there is this plan that's potentially playing out in the background that's why Chani's getting upset with Paul, because she's saying you're allowing that manipulation to control you. Okay, so the problem is that his mom is a Bene Gesserit, which is one of the sorceress witch ladies who, one of the things we learn more fully in the second movie is that they have seeded around the planets around the universe with prophecies, yeah. which are in-
this is a universe completely controlled by women.
Really, is it?
Yeah.
Funny that.
Yeah, it is. And in not nice ways.
Well, I mean, what all they're doing is trying to make babies.
And plant them in different places and not tell them who their parentage is, and but still control them.
Oh, well, that too. Okay, so it's a dynastic yeah. like plot to create particular lineages and family associations. I mean, that does sound like what women do, isn't it? Like we plan marriages.
Well, not to that level. They were all strategic. Well, they weren't planning strategic marriages, though. I mean, the emperor's daughter and Paul was a strategic marriage that Paul himself suggested in the first movie. And then he resuggested it in the second movie. And finally, was it okay to give a spoiler?
Which? Of the movie or of our discussion?
Yes,
we said, we told you guys there would be spoilers.
Okay. This is, well, so anybody who's read the book already knows this. He asks for the emperor's daughter's hand in marriage because he thinks it's going to avoid war. And the cliffhanger at the end is that it doesn't, because the other houses don't accept him. They don't accept this idea. Right. And so it's a larger war is broken out. And that's where the movie ends. That's the cliffhanger.
So these machinations of marriages and it's a breeding program, right? Which is
it's a breeding program. Yeah, like only have girls. You're only allowed to have girls. So they can somehow control their bodies to such, and I guess the men's, well, no, they control their bodies so much that, you know, after copulation, I suppose they can control, you know, which sperm would fertilize the egg to make it a girl.
Right.
That's the implication right. here, that they have such control over their bodies that they can do this. And they plant these babies, concubines all over the universe. And then they raise them up, all girls, as Bene Gesserit.
Right. So Prism is saying, not fully controlled, the women are controlling through women's tools, not explicitly. Yes. I mean, the costume, I thought the costuming of the Bene Gesserit in the movie was amazing, right? And because they're all behind veils. Yeah. And I couldn't, I think I have one later in the stack of Jessica behind a veil, but I couldn't find, it's like this is the most perfect costuming I've ever seen of these veiled witches who are behind the scenes. Yeah. Creating these alliances and associations.
Literally the hand that rocks the cradle rules the universe.
Well, yes, but they're controlling of each other too. So the Reverend Mother, although there's a Reverend Mother on Ericus, who's Jessica takes her place in, there's also the Bene Gesserit head woman. I forgot what she's called.
Well, Reverend Mother, but I don't remember what her name is.
Okay, so she's Gaius Helen Mohiam. She's the one who tests Paul for the
yes
gum jabbar.
I don't know who that actress was, but man, is she good.
Charlotte Rafling, I think.
She was very good. Jaw dropping.
She was really like stern and powerful and definitely Mother Superior the level of stuff. So the revelation of the story is the degree to which these women have been trying to manipulate the situation to a very specific conclusion, which is this the Kwisatz-Haderach.
Kwisatz-Haderach. Yeah.
He needs to be a man. Do you understand from the movies what he is?
Do I understand that he's the Kwisatz-Haderach?
No, do you understand what that means?
I thought it meant that he was going to be able to take this this serum, this water of life, and survive, because no man can, only women can survive this, and not all of them do. You nearly die when you take it. It's like poison. But when a man takes it, that surpass any Bene Gesserit ever.
What power?
It'll be extremely powerful.
What power?
That he'd be able to, his mind would become so powerful that he'd be able to move move through space and time effortlessly. Say that word today.
Yes. Yes. And that's what's interesting. It's interesting that in the second movie that feels like it fell away, right? It's like the whole point of what the Kwisatz-Haderach is, which the second movie will lead you to believe that it's mainly that he becomes this war leader, which is curious that he's.
It sounds like a sidetrack. Like he's been sidetracked into this military role.
He kind of has. That it wasn't what the Kwisatz-Haderach was supposed to do necessarily. He has been sidetracked. Now I've been sidetracked. What was I thinking? I forgot. Okay, go back to what you were just to say. The Kwisatz-Haderach, what he's supposed to do, and this what the long line of breeding was supposed to bring about was this man. I don't think it was necessarily meant to be dependent on his taking the Water of Life. That's what I remember. That the Water of Life, which comes from the worms, there's one guy called it Smurf juice.
Smurf juice, yeah, blue. I saw that.
Right, that's the kind of
acid.
A kind of prophecy thing that has been planted on Arrakis because they have the Smurf juice, but it's not clear, and I don't remember that from the book because it's not in the appendix because I got the appendix on the book that's necessarily what the Kwisatz-Haderach was supposed to be doing. He was simply the Kwisatz-Haderach was supposed to be the shortening of the way. And what you described is actually appropriate. The one who can be two places simultaneously. It was supposed to be mental powers, and it was supposed to be it's like whether you're seeing the future or you're actually like collapsing time, space, time. One way or another, that they were trying to create, interestingly, a superhuman mind.
Yes. That could create wormholes in space, ironically.
Right. Oh, yeah. Very nice. And why would we need this particular ability?
To populate other
planets. Yes, for space travel.
Spread out. Right?
And this is curiously, it's sort of lingering there. This is my one biggest like gripe with the second movie. It's like, what's the spice for? It was the sole point of driving this entire economy of why the Harkonnen want to control it, why the Atreides, you know, allegedly wanted to go in and help the Emperor there, who's on whose side. It's the control of the spice. Fine. It's a precious resource. It's not just a drug that makes you feel good or something like that. It's the thing that makes space travel possible.
Yeah. A lot of that kind of detail did get lost in all the dialogue.
They had plenty of dialogue. They had talking about swimming and sand and stuff like that. Why couldn't they actually like remind everyone?
But it seemed like they were concentrated part of the time on frivolous dialogue and part of the time on kind of, you know, young people angst about their world and their role in it dialogue. Yes. But we needed more detail about what's driving the story. And I think that was what was missing. I could sense that, even though I still think it was a fantastic movie because it was, like I said, it just transports you to another place completely. It's a great sensory experience to see this in a theater.
You're not obliged to keep defending it. We're going in. So that they distract you with the problem of the love story and the coming of age and confuse the problem of, and some of the chat is actually, yes, guys, you're right. Okay, so Id Prism, without the spice, there is no galactic empire. Exactly. And what else is there without the spice and without space travel? And this is where things get really like exciting. Right, Silent Drake was saying he would outsee and outplot the guild's best navigators. The spice is needed for the guild to navigate this passage between the planets. They completely forgot to put that in the second one. It's in there in the first movie with when they get on the big guild ships to go from the Atreides home planet to Arrakis. They have to get in one of those big guild ships. But it's very interesting that you could make the entire 3-hour second part and forget that that's what the spice is so valuable for. They're
right. So the story got lost, is what you're saying. And
like the entire mechanism of why got lost in the love story.
They put the details of him becoming this messiah and this, you know, this, you know, main chick that becomes the side chick by the end, and she stomps off and angry, and it's shallow.
I'm gonna break your heart because it's shallow for a whole nother reason at a totally another level too, right? Talk about not going deep enough in that sand, right? Okay, so we have that they're wondering about whether Paul is going to be this Kwisatz Haderach out of sequence of what they've been planning, and therefore whether you'd have these ability to guide spaceships effectively, but then also all of the other powers that come with not having computers, right? And that was interesting. One of the things that Herbert did, like, purposefully put in his backstory is the reason they need the spice in these mines is because they've disallowed AI.
I did read that in the very first chapter, right?
Yeah.
Because they would, the men would become slaves to machines.
Exactly. So he's imagining this world that has mental powers of, you know, advanced contemplation that humanity has developed and is intensified with the spice, and that the Bene Gesserit, as nuns in effect, are trying to design so that the family line will end up with this incredibly insightful man.
Mm-hmm. But had they chosen which family line was going to have that?
Oh, yeah.
Or had they forgotten?
No, they knew. Okay. And Jessica messed
it
up.
Who was it? Jessica. Oh, and she really messed it
up. She was not supposed to have a boy.
Not only that, but she did was pregnant with a girl when she drank the water of life.
Well, that too.
That was that was a really good scene when, you know, the old Bene Gesserit dies and she said, oh, you know, she gets a horror. But what have we done? She's pregnant, right? That was a good moment. Yeah.
So Alia. Another of the book problems is they compress the first book into like 6 months instead of like several years. That Alia is actually and in the David Lynch movie, she's like a kid, a toddler to be in the last scene. But I was less bothered by. I'm bothered by some of the compression of things that they took out because of that time sequence, but Alia as well. One, all the pro-life people are very excited because she's you know awake in the womb and you know and talking
and holding conversations like really intelligent ones. Actually, I did like that choice. Now the David Lynch version had this scary, smart, intelligent young actress playing her. And she was. I think her IQ, the actual actress, her IQ was just off the charts.
Oh,
and
really?
That you could actually see that on film, right? It was very appropriate. So having a baby still in utero, being that smart and talking he went a different route that way, but I think it worked really well. It's like, whoa, she hasn't even been born yet, and she's holding conversations with like wise old women. This is crazy. So you can see how powerful she is already.
But you can also see what Jessica keeps doing, which is not following instructions.
Is she possessed? Is she possessed with the spirit of the other Bene Gesserit? Because they hinted at that.
They get all the memories.
When she was saying goodbye to
Paul. Get all the memories of all.
But her voice changed, and it sounded like she was using the voice, but I don't think she was, because she wasn't directing anybody to do anything when she said we'll be waiting for you, right? Or something like we'll be watching.
She means she got all the memories.
Yeah. Okay. Not the soul though.
I don't think so. I think this is all quite mental for the most part, right?
Yeah.
And that Herbert is he's imagining what just like if you don't have AI to like stamp out human abilities, what kind of abilities can humanity develop?
Right.
And so it is all mental, but that it's going, that's why it is biological, and they need to, you know, have the breeding program has been going on for like 2,000 years. So it's a, lots and lots of families that they've been trying to connect together the right pieces to make this perfect, perfect Kwisatz Haderach, this man. So you could say a long genealogy for breeding the perfect man.
A long genealogy. It's like line of David genealogy.
Okay. So maybe this is not just about the love story, right? And the worms, right? At the top level of, I mean, what he says at the beginning of the book is this is basically ecological, right? That the dedication is to the people whose labors go beyond ideas into the realm of real materials, to the dry land ecologists, wherever they may be, in whatever time they work, this effort at prediction is dedicated in humility and admiration. Yeah, humility, haha. The worms in their desert planet are obviously the point, the title,
yeah,
and the magic of it, because it's like you've got these beings that aren't in any way made by humanity. They just live in the planet. They just live in the sand. And one thing that I'm sad they didn't bring up in the movies is what the Fremen actually call them, because they have a very interesting relationship to the spice and I do more than just guard it.
No, they create it. The worms they make it, right?
Yeah. So they're called makers.
And they eat the sand, it comes out the other end, and it's spice mixed in with
it. Makers. They're the makers, right? So we have this, what are they? Hold that thought, right? Obviously, the relation between the Fremen and the worms and the planet and the ecology. And that's why, you know, no matter how you film this, you have to do it as landscape, because the land is so much the main character, Dune.
It is the main character, like the dunes themselves, where the spice is made and the worms live and the people venerate them.
Right. Yes.
Kind of in balance.
Except for, and we do learn this from the movie, what can hurt the worms the most?
Other than being strangled to death by some woman trying to squeeze blue juice out of them.
She wasn't strangling it. She drowned it.
Yeah.
They die in water. Yeah. And that's what, I mean, this is the sort of horror of what you realize. It's like the Fremen collecting all that water and saving each other's water and sending your water into that big pond, the big reservoir.
Yes.
That will kill all the worms.
Huh.
All of the worms will die if they actually terraform the planet and make it
water. And that's their goal.
That's their irony. That's their goal.
Yeah.
To kill the makers.
And the sacred palm trees in the first one.
Yeah.
But they must know it's going to kill them though, or maybe they just thought they'd be driven further underground underneath the water, but I don't know.
They drown the little one to get the water of life. So they know they know it will kill them. So there's a really wrenching tension between what the Fremen need to be alive, which is water, and the spice, which is what makes the planet commercially and, you know, both travel and it's the perfect medium, right? The spice is medium that they need the spice for both the travel and the communication and thinking and all of that. But if they transform the planet so that the people can live there, the worms will die.
Right. So the Emperor has reason not to want to terraform it.
Exactly. Because if they terraform it, so people can live there, that they get no spice. So then we say, what is this movie about? We have a director whose name I can't say because I don't do French. Villeneuve.
That was very good.
So it's like, what is this movie about? It's like, we are trying to actually celebrate it, you guys see, even if I'm going to critique some stuff. Think about it. It has to work on all of these levels. It mostly does, with, you know, the aesthetics and the layers of storytelling and the different tensions that they are playing out. What would you say this story is about? You gave me some interesting side by sides to hint. We'll start with this one. It's two movie. Well, it's Paul standing watching the Imperial encampment with the explosion, and mm-hmm. somebody else with a cape and a sunrise and sand yes. and magnificent music and camels. Oh wait, no, there's no camels in Dune, but they're worms, right? Maybe the worms are camels.
This is the Lawrence yes. of Arabia. Yeah,
these are your pictures. Come on, yeah, I told you where they were.
Yeah, I know. You know, when I first learned the story of Dune, I actually thought it was about Afghanistan, and this is years ago because Afghanistan was the center of the Silk Road,
right?
And it's where they had the opium poppies, and I always thought that it was just a huge metaphor for the history of war and conflict in Afghanistan and empires trying to take it over. But from us discussing this over the past week, he was inspired by Algeria, things that were happening in North Africa. North Africa is definitely the aesthetic of this film.
Yes.
But it seems like a mishmash of like histories of the spice trade being mixed with native populations rising up and throwing off their colonizers. As an Algeria.
Well, I think it can be Afghanistan in the sense of yes, poppies for sure. I mean, this is one of the things that I was reading about 2 years ago. I think Jay Dyer had a link to something on Dune that shot me into thinking about Afghanistan. Like, oh my gosh. One of the things that Herbert did was like throw it all together, right? There is no one culture that he's claiming that he's drawing off of, so anywhere in Asia works.
Yeah,
although dunes work best in North Africa or therefore, I mean, so some people are saying this is a, you know, current events in the Middle East feeling movie.
Well, current events in the Middle East are the same events that happened in the Middle East 1,000 years ago, so it's a really good influence, or not, that's not the right word, inspiration for the whole story, because of all of the things that were happening all over the Middle East, well, specifically in Afghanistan and parts of India and now Saudi Arabia because of the oil, right? Although we have more oil here, which is a whole nother subject.
Well, and this, so I'd say, I mean, one of the sort of puzzling is like, who are, well, we, so we have, you know, that you have, you're finding these, finding all these pictures that are clearly potential inspirations for things like the costumes and the makeup. And here's Jessica her face tattoos.
Yeah.
And the other woman that you have, she has a cross, which suggests she's Christian. Mm-hmm.
Well, now all of the images I saw, I picked that one because it was hard to find a picture where somebody was looking straight the way Jessica is in that picture. And she also had a lot more of the lines around her neck, and Jessica has a lot of them on her face. So that was the closest one. But I saw facial tattoos that were Orthodox, that were Christian. Some of them I think might've been Islamic. Mm-hmm. It's just a North African cultural tradition, I think. Of tattooing the face for different reasons. So,
well, I think a lot of people are going to see it and think it's meant to be Islamic.
It looks it. It does. But they do the same thing in India, too.
Right.
Right. And in parts of sub-Saharan Africa, they do something similar. It's not a tattoo, but it's scarring. Right. So they prick the skin and they scar it into certain designs on the face too. So it has very similar look too, but I tried to stick with ones that were just tattoos, but it was definitely the North African aesthetic for that, mm-hmm. but that wasn't the only one, but I'll let you get to that slide.
But just thinking about, I mean, Jessica, she's meant to have, I mean, she already has certain degrees of power because of who she is as a Bene Gesserit, and she's been trained to have certain abilities. But then when we see her with the face tattoos, it's, I got confused in the movies, like before or after she'd done the Change the Water of Life, because she changes the water of life in the first movie, right?
No, she drunk it in part two. Right. And she was given a choice. That was definitely part two. She was given a choice to either become their new Reverend Mother here or die. You're going to be exiled. They were going to kick her and Paul out. So she did it to save their lives. Now I think she was adopting the culture and dress and tattoos of the people that she was serving or was serving her. Both, right, the Fremen. I think that's why she did that. But it was, yeah.
Well, okay, so I'm looking at that, and it was like, this is obviously a costuming aesthetic decision that they made to give her a certain cast. But that it in this picture that we have of her, she's standing also in front of a wall of scripture. So it's like she's been written on.
Yes.
And that feeling of...
She's part of the lore. She's part of their scriptures.
Right. She's become a living scripture. It's kind of neat.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a really cool image. It is.
And this is one of the things the book can do, but the movie can't, which is that the book, and this is why I was so confused about everything in the book when I read it when I was in high school, because, you know, it opens with, a beginning is the time for taking the most delicate care that the balances are correct. This every sister of the Bene Gesserit knows. To begin your study of the life of Modib, then, take care that you first place him in his time, born in the 57th year of the Padishah Emperor Shaddam IV, and take the most special care that you locate Modib in his place, the planet Arrakis. Do not be deceived by the fact that he was born on Caladan and lived his first 15 years there. Arrakis, the planet known as Dune, is forever his place. From the Manual of Modib by the Princess Irulan. Now, if you see the movie, you know who she is, right? But you don't know who she is in the book for ages and ages and ages. At least I don't remember. Oh. It's like, are these real? I was completely spoofed thinking that all of these, and she's writing most of it, right? She has an analysis of the Arrakeen crisis that from the humanity of Modib.
So the Empress's daughter is the narrator in the book.
She writes right. all they the did, epigraphs.
Okay, yeah.
The prince.
Right. They show her doing that in the movie.
In part two, she's dictating, right? So she's but in one of the sort of scripture allusions that the book can create that the movie had a harder time doing is giving you this feeling of being in a lore. Right.
Okay. They could have done that more. Yeah.
Well, it's one of the things that like Tolkien could pull off in Lord of the Rings. It's impossible. They kind of play with it in the movies where, you know, you have Galadriel narrating stuff and everything, but the impression of actual texts out there that carry this story, that this is just a narration from. And like I said, when I read this as a kid, 13 or 14, maybe it's 14, maybe I was 15. I can't, it does actually matter for my punchline. I thought I wasn't sure these weren't real texts. Does that make sense?
Oh.
I thought the Princess Irulan yes, must be a like real source, right? Because he has all this stuff that has, you know, all that Herbert is playing with all of these other traditions and languages. And, you know, you get to the appendices he's telling you about, you know, the history of the empire and how, you know, it's carried in the commentaries of the ecumenical translators and stuff. I didn't know what was real and what wasn't. I couldn't tell. I was so confused.
I love that Paul's, the Atreides home planet is named after Scotland because it really looked like it. And then they're going to, you know, an arid Iraq-like place.
Iraq, a lot of layers of me. I'd read Lord of the Rings. I knew somewhat a little bit what Tolkien was playing with. I figured somewhere in here this was a historical novel.
Well, it kind of is. I mean, it's definitely drawing on real history.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And this layering. So this is a lovely makeup decision on their part. It, even if it's culturally appropriate to have the face tattoos, that they gave her script. Right. So she has, as you become a living book, she's part of the living lore. It's perfect. It's absolutely outstanding. Okay. So then we have Chani, who you found another example for.
Yeah.
What do you see in that one?
I see the Afghan girl. A veteran from the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan in 1980. That she was a refugee, and she was so striking looking. And now my husband and I first saw part one. He picked up on that immediately. So she looks just like the Afghan girl. Look at her. And I said, oh, okay, right. And she, I don't think she didn't have a huge part in part one. She had an outsized part in part two, I think, because I think Zendaya was chosen for her look in this movie, definitely, because she's very striking. The Afghan girl was very striking, and she cuts an amazing, compelling, you know, figure to look at on this on the big screen, because that's a part of the mood he was setting. This mood of this faraway land that you're absorbed into when you're watching this on a large screen, right? This kind of bigger than life.
Right, but it's not
memory we all have.
It's the memory, right? That right? So we have Jessica written on, and Chani cast and costumed in a way that powerfully recalls a real memory.
Yes,
of ours.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is, and like your memory of thinking this looks like Lawrence of Arabia, and there were ways in which the way Villeneuve has done it, also recall Lawrence of Arabia cinematically, just like, you know, the slowness of being in the story, and the grandeur of the dunes and the music and the drapey costumes, right?
It's Lawrence of Arabia, right? Yeah, it's the same thing. The Arabian desert was a character in that story.
So this is beautiful movie making, right? That he's crafting you into memories that you already have, which is what Herbert is playing with in terms of his backstory of his future. Like that you are, and the Princess Irulan giving you this feeling of being in a story that's got layers and footnotes and lore.
Isn't that amazing? Yeah. Isn't that amazing? Because your brain is already got these memories in it. So he's tapping into it as he's presenting this writing, and he knows when you pick it up and read it, you're already going to be in the story.
Yes,
because your memories are already there. Some of them are.
Well, but he depends on this in his structure. I did, when I reread Dune 2 years ago, I was just like, oh, this is brilliant. I cannot believe I didn't get it, because I could appreciate more of the craft of the construction in it rather than just, oh, you know, cool names and confusing geography and some like epigraphs that made no sense. That because it's a story about memory and future, he's doing that incredibly beautifully.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's another one. Your fourth one that we tap into is a little funnier. So who are the bad guys, and why are they the bad guys, and what do they look like? And I do like your Klaus Schwab and Harkonnen, and is he nephew or son? Robin?
Nephew.
Okay. So Raid and Fade Roth and Robin are both cousins? They're cousins?
I think they're cousins. Yeah, I don't think they're brothers.
Okay, so tell us about the thoughts that went through your head in showing us this pairing.
Well, yeah, I just thought I was thinking of different images to use. I just stuck that in because I thought it was hilarious.
Comic relief at some point would be kind of needed.
It's been a comic relief. On the other hand, you know, Klaus Schwab is a wannabe world dictator. So, and he dressed like one, and that, you know, that was memed a lot, you know, who wore it better.
Right.
Right. That's it. Was it Harkonnen or Klaus Schwab? Who wore it better? They resemble each other, and in costume and baldness and width and
with the actor playing Robin, I couldn't forget. I've seen him in Guardians of the Galaxy with all his tattoos in that one. So I was having a hard time seeing him in black and white, right? Because Guardians of the Galaxy is like red and blue or something.
So it's hard to recognize. Yeah. It's true. But say he was in another Villeneuve movie. Blade Runner 2049.
Oh, right. I didn't see that one.
He was in it briefly in the beginning. And that's another, he seems to be making his mark with these, you know, large, beautiful vistas and sets in different worlds. The last three movies of his I've seen, everything on the set has just been absolutely huge. I mean, the buildings are huge, the cities are huge, the landscapes are huge. The sound is huge on both of them. Very, very prominent. So, but anyway,
that went off on a different direction. The worm just skittered off into
different
direction. The sand.
Talking about the director's stuff, but yeah. So yes, it's Klaus Schwab and Robin Harkonnen.
Okay, so this is suggesting that some of the power of what's going on in the movie is because it's tapping into images, tropes, cultures. I'd say it's a sort of tricky thing because do we need to know what they are in order to appreciate them? And say we did not do I saw the movie on Saturday. We put this together in days, right? So you can say we haven't spent years like I have with Tolkien trying to find all of the layers and resonances and things like that. People are responding to the movie without necessarily knowing anything else. So there's a power,
like myself,
there's a power to it that I get curious about, right? And then I ended up in an argument with my husband, right? So what's the power? Why does it work? At what level is it working? I definitely think it's at more than just the level of fun parallels between the way villains look. Although I think that's probably part of it. And I wanted to test out on you all some of the thoughts that I've had. Okay, so what are the worms?
They live
in sand. Mm-hmm. But we've had, this actually was kind of nice moment. It's like Paul telling Chani it could be water, right? So if it was his planet, this would all be water, which I think is a fun hint. The worms, what are they? I suppose in story structure, character. My husband said this straight off the bat. So this is easy. They
I don't know.
I will show you. They're whales.
Oh,
it's Moby Dick.
Yeah. All right, Moby Dick.
One, Herbert is obviously doing this. This is two with the point that we play with when we think about why stories work. Why do they have the power they do? Why do they get you in your gut? A love story is a love story, right? It's about men and women and sex, babies, right? So that has to have a certain kind of power. We're human beings telling these stories. That's only going to work if it taps into that level of understanding, like coming of age, taking power. That is mechanisms of women taking power over who gets babies with each other. Well, what shall we call that? Oh, Bridgerton. We're doing that in another episode. You know, power structures. How are we playing out this knowledge, prophecy? Dune is a magnificent book, and this is a magnificent movie because somehow, even when you're not consciously aware of it, it's like tapping into something so real that it's not made up, right? They don't hunt the worms to kill them, obviously, but they do harpoon them effectively, right? The whole sort of in the trailer that we watched at the beginning, right, when he's shooting his little hooks out, right? That's a harpoon, yeah, for goodness sake. And he's going to have to chase that whale onto the waves, hook it, and then if you've read Moby Dick, right, they have to harpoon them and then have the whales drag them in the little boats until the whale gets tired.
Mm-hmm.
And then they can kill it and take its spice. Oil, yeah, ambergris. It's whaling. It's whaling.
Yes.
Right. And so the dunes as the sea is like, it's like, it's this interesting kind of, the twinning is very interesting here, right? That the dunes, yes, are the sea and the worms are the whales. So these giant animals.
And they breach. They breach the surface just like a whale. True. I had not seen that. That's pretty good observation.
And I actually saw this on somebody else's video mentioning it in YouTube, right? So we were not the only ones who ever have seen this. So that at that level, it's at least that obvious, right? It's a little deep, but mm-hmm. not as deep as the whale goes, right? That there's a feeling of the hunt, obviously, in it. Although they don't kill the worms to ride them, but the feeling of the hunt is powerful.
Well, I mean, it's more like breaking a wild horse, right? Trying to catch it and ride it.
Or, and you know, they have, the way they use them in battle, they're a bit like war elephants too.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they take their teeth to make their knives. That's elephant-like.
Mm-hmm. It is. Yeah.
They're kind of a brilliant amalgam of various animals.
Yeah. I hadn't thought of it, but yeah.
Hold that thought. Okay. Who are the Harkonnen?
Oh, okay.
This should be easier. Come on. I showed you the pictures beforehand.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, you've got pictures of the Nazi rally, which is obviously the inspiration for that.
But it's the inspiration for all the baddies. Now, guess what? Who are the Nazis?
Who are the Nazis?
Yes. So we have suggested to you all already, Mel, shush, you're giving it away. I'm not reading the comment that she just left.
Oh, I want to hear it later.
She's right. We're getting there. If you think about the sort of inversions that they're playing with between the worms and the whales,
mm-hmm.
land and sea, and then the thing that worked best for me in the movie, absolute best. This is, it's like of the coming of age things. And when, let's see, the major spoiler alert. Who are Paul and Jessica? They find out who they actually are. Because.
Oh, who are Paul and Jessica? Mm-hmm. Are they supposed to be Christ and his mother?
No, don't go there yet. Because I don't think, okay. I think it's, to get to that layer, we haven't, who is Jessica? I mean, in the story, who is Jessica? It's shown in the movie.
Well, she was the Duke's concubine. She wasn't his wife.
No. Who is she?
But,
you didn't see the movie. Weren't you paying attention? She finds out who she is.
Oh, that. Yes. Okay.
Yes, because it's in the book. It's quite. They haven't read the book yet. It's too late.
Yeah, she's Baron Harkonnen's daughter,
which makes Paul his granddaughter, his grandson, right?
Grandson.
And Alia, right, too. In the Lynch movie, she kills him, right? So they're Harkonnen. The whole.
But she didn't know that.
Well, Jessica didn't know it until Alia tells her, I think.
Right, Jessica didn't know, but her daughter does.
And so all of this, like, yes, talk about lineage and breeding and who are you? And the whole mm-hmm. point of it is, you know, Paul is an Atreides and I have my ducal ring. And are they Christ and his mother? Only he's Messiah, right? There's like this playing off of the degree to which he's supposed to be some kind of Messiah figure, because that's the whole problem with the Maudib. Is he?
Yeah.
Right? But the big reveal, which we told you there would be spoilers, that being that they're actually Harkonnen. Do you remember what he says after he finds that out?
After he finds...
In the movie. He says something. This like pinged for me because I'm looking for...
So, I don't remember.
We will be Harkonnen.
Who?
Paul, right? that he, the whole point of the entire movie, the way they've set it up, is it's revenge for the murder of his father and the Atreides line, right? The yes. movie opens with they're burning all the piles of corpses, and that's all of the yeah. Atreides soldiers, and Leto is dead, and the entire revenge story is revenge for my father against his killer.
Right, who is his grandfather.
And yeah. then it turns into, well, then we are not going to fight like Atreides anymore, as my father would have done. We'll fart like Harkonnen.
Oh, I missed that. Yeah. So that's a turning point. That's a bad turning point for him.
Yes, and that's...
because they're cruel.
That we will now be as cruel as the Harkonnen.
Yeah. And you can actually see him turning there. And I did pick up on that, that he was he was having to struggle against revenge. And when he finds out he's a Harkonnen, that might have been a turning point for him to say, well, screw that.
Yes, exactly. And that's, yeah. you know, in the movie, that's when Chani starts getting upset with him, right? Because it's like, you're using the Fremen to exact your revenge. And that Paul has, yeah. in the movie, completely embraced being as ruthless as the Harkonnen. So now I ask you again, like, who are the Nazis? And this is, so in the movie, obviously, visually, bad guys are always shown as Nazis. And the Harkonnen camp and army here is, you know, Villeneuve has definitely done it. And they're straight up echoing Triumph of the Will, which everybody does, because all movie demonstrations of imperial evil-like power show marching ranks of soldiers like this at Nuremberg.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Who are the Nazis imitating?
Who are the Nazis imitating? I actually don't know.
They're going to be the Third Reich.
The Nazis are imitating the Third Reich?
They are the Third Reich. They're going to be the Third Reich.
Yeah.
What is the Third Reich? Which Reich would it be?
Don't know.
Rome.
Oh.
Right? It's Rome again, right? And then I started, so because, you know, you guys at Unauthorized, we've all, you know, you're reading your Castelia leather-bound Shorter Cambridge Medieval History, so I figured all, like, I had to do reading too. So I started reading, and it starts with Constantine, Rome under Constantine. I'm like, oh my gosh, it's right there. this is where my husband and I started disagreeing, because I'm reading about Rome and I'm going, it's always Rome. Like, which is the good, who are the good guys and who are the bad guys? Wait a minute. Are we Rome? So think about, Herbert was born in 1920. What movies would he have seen growing up? Well, Spartacus came out in 1965, so that doesn't actually... Wait, when does Spartacus come out? Lawrence of Arabia came out in 62. I started... It's like, this is... Okay, so this is going to take a little unpacking. I've got Gladiators on scene here, right? And we've got Fade and Fade Ruth and Paul fighting, right? Combat, right? Single combat. We've seen... whatever his name, Fade, right? In the amazing black and white gladiatorial scene where he just gets to fight drugged Atreides, except for one who isn't, right? For his birthday. But that is absolutely clearly meant to be a Roman Colosseum.
He might have been inspired by Ben-Hur. I mean, I think there was a production of that in the late 1920s, I think.
Well, I spent a few years ago at Christmas watching all these sword and sandal movies.
Yeah, we watched Ben-Hur again.
And all of these 1950s and 1960s movies of Rome, right? Now, in those movies, are Rome the good guys or the bad guys?
Oh, they're always the bad guys.
Sure.
Rome? Rome is always the bad guy in all these movies.
They're not. No, they're America.
Oh. I thought you were talking about the 1950s movie.
They are. And you realize all of these guys, they're all about, you know, serving well in the army. Do you see what I'm doing here? If you don't know, but
no,
will.
I don't.
Okay, look, so I know I'm making it teasing because this is what I, it's like coming to this and going, wait a minute. So Paul says we have to become like Harkonnen to defeat the Harkonnen. And I thought that scene, it's back in our worm slide where the worms are coming out and you've got two armies running at each other. And if you recognize, if you pay attention to that in the movie, you can't tell the difference.
No.
The Fremen charging and the Harkonnen charging are the same thing. Right. And
it looks the same.
And that's to tell those not in Draco Chemist's writing team. That's one of the things we've been talking about a lot. The way everything ends up mirrored. Mm-hmm. America imagined itself as Rome. Look at our Capitol building. Look at the name of it. Capitol, yeah. Right? The Capitol is called from Jupiter Capitoline, the deity of Rome. We have a Roman temple in our Capitol built city, the Capitol, right? We got obelisks. We got Lincoln memorials that look straight up like Zeus in, you know,
yeah, that
Greek temples.
Strange when you see it up, right? Up close, like standing in front of it. It's like, this seems wrong. That was my reaction of it. I was an adult and I was like, ugh.
Now you see. Yeah. So if we have an empire, I mean, you say, yes, it's all the empire is always the baddies. Like, are we sure? Are we sure the empire is always the baddie? Are we sure we're not the empire? Are we sure? I mean, it's like we keep making these movies, well, Darth Vader and yeah. movie, you know, marching.
That's the
marching
question. Are we sure we're not the empire?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there can be multiple empires fighting against each other at the same time, too. But if you take on the qualities of the people you're fighting, what's the difference?
Well, so my husband, who's going to play my foil in all of this, said, no, they're the Sassanids. And I'm like, okay, I got to that chapter next in the Cambridge Medieval History. Sure, Cambridge Medieval History. Rome gives us our law. It gives us our military tradition. It gives us our architecture. It gives us, you know, concepts of imperial citizenship and such. America imagined itself as Rome. I mean,
when we were creating ourselves, they were modeling themselves after the Roman Senate.
Yes.
So, but I think that Roman or Greek revival, classical revival style was popular in other countries too. Well, British countries. I don't know if they were popular on the continent.
Oh yeah, that's why the Nazis use it.
Was I meant in the 1700s.
No, the reason I hope I have this right. Somebody look it up for me. The Third Reich. Yes, it prism. You're doing very well tonight. Makes sense that Lincoln the First Emperor would be Zeusified. Yes, Lincoln sitting on a throne with fasces on it. He's literally a fascist emperor because he's got fasces on the hand, the armrests in his chair in the Lincoln Memorial. Yeah. So no, that we have that the Roman Empire is the Roman Empire, the classical one, right? And then throughout the Middle Ages, we have the Holy Roman Empire, which is not strictly speaking Germany. It's like complicated, but the kings of the Germans tended to get crowned as emperor. And so the Holy Roman Empire has the Nazis are trying to revive that, right? So
are they trying to revive the Holy Roman Emperor without the holy part?
they're definitely playing off the aesthetic of empire, which I put to you.
Yeah.
All you have to do is see. Oh, our current president gives some speeches. We should have put that in the slide. Yeah,
dark Brandon. We should have put that in the slide.
Then I'd persuade you easier. I think it's like so if we see the knife fight between Paul and Feodrouth, and we have the Spartacus fight between Spartacus and the black slave, both gladiators, who's the good guy in those pictures? And the thing is, I was like, okay, Feodrouth is wearing black. And the gladiator that Spartacus is fighting has black skin, right? But are you sure that you can tell just from the pictures which one is the good guy?
Well, you can't tell which is the good guy. You can only infer who's the bad guy, and the bad guy is the emperor making them fight.
Oh, possibly, yes.
Because, I mean, they were forced into it.
Yes. Right. Ha! That's interesting. Okie dokie. The gladiators are forced into fighting. Now, and the, you know, my point about this is, I think the West generally has a schizophrenia about the Roman Empire. So the Sassanids as the power against the Roman Empire is interesting because they're the Persians. You could say that the Iraqian opposition to the Harkonnen Empire is Sassanid versus Roman, which it does make certain amounts of sense. But my sense is, and this is, I failed to persuade my husband, but I'll suggest it now. The glory that was Rome haunts all modern storytelling in English for sure. And you know, all of these other European traditions too, because on the one hand, they're the bad guys. They're definitely the bad guys. They, you know, threw the Christians to the lions. But on the other hand, they're the good guys because they give the structure of civilization. Ask anybody in the current political conversation which one is which. Right?
Rome is fascinating because it created such impressive and beautiful structures in architecture and structures in law that are still copied today.
Right.
And yet they were incredibly cruel.
Exactly.
And it's strange. It's a strange contrast. How can people that created such beauty be so cruel? And they were cruel. They give the Harkonnens a run for their money. For sure.
Easily. Shown in either Lynch or Villeneuve's movies. Yeah, the Romans were amazingly cruel. I mean, these gladiatorial games, they just bring people. I mean, the gladiators train to kill each other, which is the point in the Spartacus movie, which is pretty well done. But Dune had to end with a cool gladiator fight, right? Don't you think?
Yeah.
Isn't it cool that Paul gets to kill his cousin?
Oh,
yeah.
I don't know if that was cool, but that was another turning point for him, I think, because he did it so well. He treated it so casually. Hey, cousin. Right.
But it has to be, a duel to the death, and it's okay because Paul's our good guy, right? Because we've shown Faye, licking his knife to test how sharp it is.
Yeah, you don't care that he's dead because, right, he was very cruel, and the actor was amazing playing him. He just, the coldness, I mean, you can feel a change in air temperature just watching him on the screen. He was very good.
Wait, are we rooting for the villain now?
Not rooting for the villain. I'm saying you don't care that he's dead, that he has to die simply because, you know, Paul's story continues, and you kind of know that. So, the odds are stacked against him that way already.
He's story fodder, you're telling me. He's not even cannon fodder. He's story fodder.
He's story fodder.
He gets to be killed because Paul, who kills people just like he does in battle, having just realized that they're both Harkonnens, is the good guy because he's the good. Really?
Well, he could see. I think he still could be the good guy. I think he's. And if he, if,
all right,
if,
it's if okay. Here, was, are we going to go for good guy? He's rallying them, rallying his people on a mountain, standing on a mountain. Crowds listening to him. Rally. Got another movie here. Rally, standing on a mountain.
Yeah.
I take it. Did you recognize the one that I paired with Paul on the mountain?
I didn't. It almost looked. Was it Masada? I was trying to figure it out.
No, it's not Masada. It's a movie that came out the same year Dune was published, which is interesting. Very beautifully filmed in the desert. A lot of robes, right? I had a lot of trouble when I'm watching Dune, and particularly the crowd scenes when they're all the people in the very pale, flowy laundry robes. The color palette against the rocks and the sky and everything, constantly like this movie that this other picture is taken from. That's Jesus on the mount giving the Sermon on the Mount, if you didn't know.
That's a Sermon on the Cliff. That's not
well, they filmed it in Utah, okay, and in Death Valley.
That's why I thought it was Masada because it was a cliff face.
No, it's the greatest story ever told, and it's 1965, and it's the okay. It's the snorefest of snorefests of Jesus movies. I could not believe how slow it was. You want you like grandeur and like giant landscapes and slow dialogue. Go for the greatest story ever told. Yeah. It's intense. But Patrick Coffin loved it, so I had to watch it. And well, obviously, right? So Dune is worrying about what happens when a religious leader becomes all powerful and able to lead armies. I mean, the logic behind Jesus being crucified is he could have done that.
Yeah.
Was he supposed to do that?
Jesus.
Yeah. And of course the tension in Dune, because of the prophecies and the temptation of, you know, being able to see into the future with the drug and the fervor. I mean, I didn't put in a picture of Stilgar, too bad. Where when Chani is saying, you know, not real, none of this is real. And Stilgar saying, I believe. Yeah. Whose belief is this? Whose faith? You know, it's like, this is a movie about faith, obviously. Go ahead.
It's a movie about the you know, the manipulation of faith, and they didn't pull any punches saying, yeah, the Bene Gesserit orchestrated all of this. Right. And even Paul's explaining to them how they can take this poison and live because they've learned how to control their bodies. Through meditation, he's explaining this to it's not Gurney, what is his name? It's Javier Bardem's character. I can't remember.
Stilgar.
Yeah, explaining this to him. It's like, you know, I'm not your messiah. They go, oh, but you did this. He goes, yeah, they can do that. The intercessor can do that. He's trying to explain it to them, but he's still being pushed into this role because their faith is still sound. Like, oh no, you're totally it. None of that matters. But you know, you are.
So
the,
which of them is right?
You are the Messiah. I don't. Well, Paul's rejected it. I think he's rejected it, and at the same time, he is starting to use it because he's being pushed into it by his mother and Gurney. And because he's angry at discovering his parentage, he's angry about the death of his father. He's angry that the Fremen have been brutalized by the Harkonnen. And so I think the anger is getting the better of him.
So it's straight up a revenge flick. It's going to be a snuff flick is about revenge.
It could go either way. I think it could go either way in a part three if he's going to change the story.
Well, he has already changed the story in a way I'm about to tell you.
So maybe he'll do some more.
But so this is the you know, some people actually liked this demonstration, right? That we are being shown the degree to which all religion is manipulation.
Yeah, I didn't catch religious hatred there, in any part of this movie.
You didn't. I was reeking with it by the end. I was like, ah.
No, actually, I saw the argument between younger people and older people about faith is bunk, and no, faith is not bunk, and a guy they think might be a messiah saying, "I'm not your messiah," and people saying, "No, you have to be him." That's almost like a sideline to it's. It's presented as these people's beliefs are genuine, and these other people who are tired of war and fighting are starting to associate their faith with this war, which doesn't make any sense because their faith isn't dependent upon a war. They've only been at war for 80 years. Their faith, because the Bene Gesserit seeded it there, should go back centuries, not 80 years.
80 years is an interesting time frame.
Why is that?
Given that's how long Israel has existed, almost.
Oh, that's right. Oh, that's what people were talking about. They were saying, yeah, after 80 years, it's going to be a change.
Right. I do not suspect Villeneuve of putting that level of current political commentary in it. One, because he made this movie before October 7th, and it was supposed to release then, but.
Okay, but it's not a new observation.
No, but it was delayed by the writer's strikes, I think, rather than current events. Right, but this, so, the thing is, there is an appendix 2 in Dune called The Religion of Dune, right? So if you have, and there's only three appendices, right? So we can assume that religion featured in, we have appendix 1, The Ecology of Dune, appendix 2, The Religion of Dune, and appendix, oh wait, there are four. Appendix 3, Report on Bene Gesserit Motives and Purposes, and appendix 5, The Almanac in Ashraf. Right, so we figure religion really matters here because we got a whole appendix on it.
Oh no, it does matter, but I know that Frank Herbert despised Catholicism, and he
did he really?
Well, it's what his son said when he wrote a book. My father said his aunts tried to brainwash him. I don't think you understand.
Well, they tried to brainwash him. Do you think any of it stuck?
Oh, I think a lot of it stuck. Yeah, I think there's a lot of this. I mean, yeah, religion is a main theme running, you know, threading through this entire story.
It is the story, right? It's like Dune Messiah is not called Dune Messiah by accident, right? So it's this is a story about something having to.
If I read the book and I detect it wouldn't surprise me just because of the interview his son gave, the book he wrote about him, but I didn't see it in the movie. I thought it was just presented as a fact, and it is a fact that people argue over it, over whether or not it's real, whether or not it's manipulative, whether or not it gives real hope or false hope.
So I thought that Jessica is depicted as the most manipulative of them all. In fact, she is actually because she went against the Bene Gesserit and conceived Paul.
She turned into a bad guy like before your eyes.
Well, okay, so this is an interesting. You asked is it Jesus and his mother? You know what, I've got it on screen now. The single most striking image for me in the whole movie. I mean, her face being written on is kind of interesting. She's the text of the prophecy. Great. Mm-hmm. When they are about to put her on one of the worm whales and take her south, right? They put her in this conveyance, this litter, right?
Yes.
Oh, that was so interesting.
The Ark of the Covenant. Oh, yeah. Huh?
What else gets carried on, you know, as a litter on, you know, and yes.
A queen.
She's the Ark, right? And this is whoever designed that prop. Kudos, right? Because whether you meant to or not, that nailed it, right? And this then I get wondering, it's like, so if Herbert's son says he was raised Catholic, in the religion of Dune, he pretends that he's basically like mushed together everything. He says things like just a flavor of it to get, you know, before the coming of Maudib, the Fremen of Arrakis practiced a religion whose roots in the Mahomet Sari are there for any scholar to see. I love all this. It's like there's all this scholarship behind, and actually Herbert researched a lot to put the book together. So fair enough. Mm-hmm. But this is made up. Many have traced the extensive borrowings from other religions. Oh, indeed. The most common example is the Hymn to Water, a direct copy from the Orange Catholic liturgical manual calling for rain clouds, which Arrakis had never seen. But there are more profound points of accord between the Kitab al-Ibar of the Fremen and the teachings of the Bible, Ilm and Fiqh. I don't know whether Ilm and Fiqh are real. Any comparison of the religious beliefs dominant in the Imperium up to the time of Maudib must start with the major forces which shaped those beliefs. The followers of the 14 sages, whose book was the Orange Catholic Bible and whose views are expressed in the commentaries and other literature produced by the Commission of Ecumenical Translators, CET. The Bene Gesserit, who privately denied their religious order, but who operated behind an almost impenetrable screen of ritual mysticism, and whose training, whose symbolism, organization, and internal teaching methods were almost wholly religious. The agnostic ruling class, including the guild, for whom religion was a kind of puppet show to amuse the populace and keep it docile, and who believed essentially that all phenomena, even religious phenomena, could be reduced to mechanical explanations. 4.
That's so Marxist.
One more, four. The so-called ancient teachings, including those preserved by the Zen Sunni wanderers from the first, second, and third Islamic movements, the Nava Christianity of Chasuk, the Buddhist-Islamic variants of the types dominant at Lankival and Sikkun, the blend books of the Mahayana Lankavatara, the Zen Hegikanshu of Three Delta Pavonis, the Torah and Talmudic Zabur surviving on Seleucus Secundus, the pervasive Obeah ritual, the Muad Quran, with its pure ilm and fiqh preserved among the Pundi rice farmers of Kaladin. I'm so amazed I made it this far. The Hindu outcroppings found all through the universe in little pockets of insulated pions, and finally the Butlerian Jihad. There is a fifth force which shaped religious belief, but its effect is so universal and profound that it deserves to stand alone. This, of course, is space travel. Herbert does a really good job of leaving you completely confused about whether any of this, he believes any religion is real.
Do you think he did that on purpose?
Oh, yeah, as a storyteller.
Because he wanted to blend everything together. And so that people would conclude that all religions are the same and they all do the same thing and they all have the same purpose, which is to control people, as in the opiate of the masses.
Well, so this is why it's like, I think Herbert is a better storyteller than he is a philosopher of religion, that's for sure. And curiously, his storytelling trumps his stupid philosophy of religion. But that, you know, he recognizes that there's written traditions that have commentaries, and he plays off that a lot. He has a meeting that the mm-hmm. CET comes out of, trying to figure out how they're going to create an ecumenical thing that then sparks religious wars everywhere when they try to find something that everybody will agree on. It doesn't work. The Bene Gesserit, whose internal teaching methods were almost wholly religious, what does that mean then? Right? Are they, religion? How can you have holy religious teaching methods if it's all bunk, right?
Right. He thinks it's all the same. Yeah.
But I don't think he thinks it is. The Bene Gesserit actually have ascetic contemplative practices that work.
Yeah, but he thinks it's all the same because of its, the word was there and it jumped right out of my head, back out of my head. They have the same, not necessarily the same methods, but the same goal, which is to control people.
He says that's what the agnostic ruling class believes, right? And there he's like straight up with Rousseau and, you know, Enlightenment philosophy. What you do is keep the populace docile with...
Right, but Paul sees this even in part one when he screams at his mother after the father's been killed and they've been exiled and they crashed, and he said, "You made me a freak."
Right.
What did you do to me? Right. And this is just some months after he's gone through. What is that ritual where he puts his hand in the box?
Gumjavar.
He's gone through that, and you can see even then he's like angry that this woman he doesn't know is telling his mother what to do, and is how you dare use that voice on me. He knows his own importance already, and he doesn't like it. He definitely doesn't like her because he doesn't like the way she bosses everybody around. It's like, who are you? Right. So I think
that's expressing
the implication
well
there is
Herbert's
that they're
frustration.
Controlling people, and he doesn't.
That's expressing well Herbert's frustration with controlling women.
With controlling women or controlling religion?
Well, the nuns that his son mentioned that he, you know, raised him.
Oh, his aunties were nuns and they raised him?
That he was schooled by, like, nuns, and the Bene Gesserit is kind of rhymes with Jesuit, so it's...
It does. I thought Benedictine Jesuit is what it sounds like to me.
So it's all this blend. And then his ancient teachings are all like, you know, the Buddha Islamic, Nava Christianity,
Mahayana.
I mean, everything is mished together, right? And
it's all the same.
And he's orange Catholic, so Protestant, like Irish, right? The orange and the green. Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Yeah.
That... Sure. So, but the thing is, this is still a book that's all about religion. So Silent Draco is saying Herbert inverted religion in the book. He did, but I'm trying to make the argument that it didn't work. I mean, it works at certain levels, but the story has the power that it does because Herbert couldn't get away from it.
The religion he created in the Bene Gesserit and in the Fremen waiting for their... I guess I forget what they call their Messiah. Was it Maudib? Was just his name. That was the name he chose.
Right.
But there were the Mahdi, I think they called it, which is from Islam, right? Yes. The 12th Imam, right?
The one who will lead us to paradise, the Mahdi.
Right. Right. So they were waiting for him. I think the Bene Gesserit themselves and what they do is sounds more to me like what I suspect the Druids might have done 2,000 years ago in the Roman Empire, which is they just influenced people. They didn't have any real power. They weren't nobles, but they influenced people who did have power, from my very basic understanding of it.
Well, so the Benedict, I'll go back to him. My picture of the Ark comes from Tissot's Old Testament images, right? These are very, very famous illustrations of the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, that Tissot did in the 19th century. I'm blanking on his first names, Joseph, James, whatever. These images were incredibly popular in like Sunday school shows and stuff like that. They had slideshows, magic lantern shows that would use them in England and such. They are basically the stage setting templates for every movie ever made since, because he did so many of them.
Interesting.
Yeah, he did so many of them that the early Bible drama movie makers looked to his pictures for like how to do Jerusalem, how to do these crowd scenes, how to do so all of those like white flowy robes that we see in Dune ultimately come from Tissot's drawings, right? And including that Jesus is always in white, right? In the sort of blinding white, you know, there are others in the 19th century that put him in white too, but he's always in white and he's surrounded by the people in the draped robes and stuff. Now, what's interesting about that is Tissot, who we've talked about before, went and traveled in the Holy Land to find models for his pictures. And you found, Jessica looking like these modern women with their facial tattoos and stuff. My sense was she looks also in costume exactly like, for example, as I'm showing here, Mary Magdalene in Tissot's paintings. That Herbert may have thought that he was undoing all of the religious instruction that he'd been given.
Oh, no, I don't think that worked.
Didn't work at all, right? that he's able to write a story that's so incredibly powerful. This is my main point. That's so incredibly powerful is because he never got away from the teaching that he grew up with. And he can pretend that he did. I mean, his son denied that he did like the psilocybin and stuff like that. Who knows? Mushrooms. He's writing this in the early 60s. He's writing it when like psychedelic drugs, obviously all the stuff with the spice and the water of life and the transform it and go crazy if you take the LSD, has got to be behind that. But deep, deep below that is he would not write an entire book about religion if it wasn't something he was wrestling with.
Well, yeah, as I said, I didn't detect any religious hatred in the depiction of it, mistrust of these women for sure. So maybe you're right. Maybe it's not. He has a serious problem with women because they're the real bad guys in this. They're manipulating them. They're manipulating all of the men and all of the dukes and the barons and the emperor himself.
But I mean, isn't there? This is where I think Villeneuve and his co-writer did change the book to a certain extent, because in the book, this level of, you know, those, the Bene Gesserit seed prophecies But on the other hand, Paul and Jessica actually can see the future. So, and then Paul says, well, you know, I see multiple futures. I'm going to pick one. It's like, that is the way the Mentat and the Guild do their work, right? With being able to see possible routes. So there's like the fake religion that the Guild thinks it's using to control everybody. And then there's what I think people are responding to in the movie is you're surrounded by, well, okay, I'll say it out loud, liturgy, right? You are surrounded by people in liturgical robes chanting sacred music. And
well, people are constantly praying in this movie.
But the whole movie is a prayer.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. It was hinted at in part one a bit, right before Duncan Idaho has to fight and he gets killed. The men are preparing coffee using their own spit, which is gross, but that's what they do. And but they're also using these Islamic prayers.
Yes.
And yeah, so it's threaded throughout the story. So if it's not a religious story, it's definitely the main driver of it.
I'm saying the whole movie is a religious experience.
Oh, okay. Hmm.
I'm saying maybe. The reason people are responding to it, it's like they're going to be frustrated with me saying, oh, you know, they messed up the story. So nobody cares, right? They want to go and be surrounded by beauty, one, right? It's a gorgeously beautiful movie. The music, right? It's, I mean, whatever those aunties that tried to get Herbert to be more religious did, he clearly went to mass.
Right? Yeah.
And Villeneuve, we found out he went to seminary, which we were trying to figure out whether it's like that's a seminary, like high school or something. But
yeah, it's just
it's the same effect of in Barbie, right? Where Barbie is clearly the virgin. Mary, in her beauty and her, you know, guardianship and prayers for the community and, you know, what does it mean to be incarnate and all of that. Yay! This is a fundamentally Catholic movie, guys. Ha ha. Right? And
yeah.
And the thing is, it is in spite of itself because, and Tolkien did this on purpose, right? It's like he sort of tried to write the story that had the right feel of the world and the beauty and the praise and the prayer, the maker. Oh my gosh, right? It's like, could it be any more obvious? The worms are the maker.
Yeah.
The worms create life. The worms give us insight. They, you know, it's all of this. It's like the yearning for the sacred and the worship is so powerful, even when he's got in his little appendix trying to pretend that he's created this world that he can be really like aloof and skeptical about. He can't. And I what I'm saying is neither can here we have the ladies in their, you know, like nuns' robes, right? And this, the power of this liturgically paced meditation on sin, obviously.
There's very strong images of Catholicism in there with the use of the water of life.
That poor baptized worm that dies. It's kind of baptismal pool for the worm to die in, I suppose. No, so yes, Tim Smith saying religious manipulators stunned to encounter the real thing. Rainline, it was good, but not that good. Well, it's Viconian thunder. Yes, it's the echoes are there. And I mean, the reality of the truth, guys, is it's real, right? It's like if you're going to tell a super duper powerful story that's going to tap into reality at a level that people deeply, deeply respond to, and if it works, you, in spite of yourself, are going to have to tap into, in fact, the reality that we inhabit. And it's so interesting. We've been saying this in Draco Alchemicus in our poetry work. It's like if you go for beauty, it's tied up with truth and virtue, right? Yes. Which is the sort of tension, I think, that's in the movie of the desire for virtue and the horror of exactly what level of virtue we're going to be able to demonstrate.
Mm-hmm. I wonder what drives Jessica to do what she did. The Reverend Mother accuses her of just being arrogant.
So this, by now I'm at a layer that's different from the actual like characters' motivations, right? Imagine them as actors. I think what's happened in the making of the movie and the effect and the desire for, I think the well, I've had dual responses from younger people. So, I mean, we're of an age, you and I are an age, and you can feel like we remember when there was reverence in the world. And we've gone through a period of like horrible corruption, and I mean the level of propaganda and nonsense that we've been subjected to for since 1965 when I was born. It's just off the charts, right? Ugliness and David Lynch's movie version of this is a good example.
yeah
And everyone's responding to this like longing for beauty. It's amazing. It's glorious. It's lovely. And it's in spite of ourselves wanting other kinds of stories, I think, right? Which is where I did get upset. Okay, so we have the like unintended accident, like the deep level of religious, and then there is the actual ending of the movie. Okay, so we have Paul with Princess Irulan and Chani. What did you think of the ending of the movie? Spoiler alert, you guys, we don't care.
The ending of the movie was just a cliffhanger. You know, Paul asks for the hand of the Emperor's daughter. She accepts immediately. She's very angry.
And does and leaves.
And stomps off. And who can blame her, really? Paul makes it clear that he loves her and he always will, and then immediately it proposes to the Emperor's daughter. The other grand great houses across the universe don't accept the marriage as a stop for a war. So now they're, and I don't quite understand why they're all going to war now.
Are they going to war
over control of Arrakis?
So we started with, is this a love story, right? It's like, if this is in fact Paul and Chani's love story, pretty sucky ending.
Yeah, it's a cliffhanger ending. Because the house has said, we don't accept that, I'm like, oh, that's the out the writer director gave them. Oh, I don't have to marry her now. But that's a huge part of the book, so I don't think they can get away with that. But he doesn't have to marry her because the reason for it's no longer a strategic marriage.
Wait, so he wrecked his relationship with Chani for something that doesn't work diplomatically. That's pretty dumb.
Yeah, right. And it happened immediately, which is kind of strange, but yeah.
And Chani goes off and, you know, she's going to ride her own worm because she's a girl boss.
Well, they all, the girls and the boys in this movie all fight equally.
Equally, eh?
But yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I hated that speech. It was, oh my gosh, no, we're equal here and you're not. You're from great houses. I'm like, oh God.
Okay, now I'm finally finding something that bugged you.
No, that bugged me because it just seemed out of place. It's like, why is she pontificating about...
Oh, why indeed?
Everything being equal. They weren't trying. They did a good job of keeping it down to a minimum. But her friend, Chani's friend, I don't remember her name. You see her just before she's executed at the end, towards the end of the movie. And they mention, you killed 9 men, right?
Like, girl boss.
Yeah, sure you did.
We've girl bossed it. And Chani's going to girl boss her way out and go, you know, like, she's not going to be deceived by all the propaganda and the lies and stuff. She's going to go girl
really
boss her
about
way.
This
what?
Is like what's really stupid about that is Jessica's the most powerful woman in the universe right now because of what she did. Her daughter, she's carrying something more powerful than she is. And yet we got to get treated to, a noble girl boss death as if she were a knight from the Middle Ages.
Yeah, it's not the...
Who killed 9 men. She's Q Holland. She killed 9 men with a swing of one swing of her axe, you know? It's kind of silly.
Yeah, it's completely not the way the book ends. And... this is the one thing I stuck with me for years because I didn't know what the word concubine meant.
Oh.
To which my husband said, you didn't read your Bible very much. And I'm like, well, you know, come on. I didn't know what concubine meant. And the entire scene that you've just described does not happen in the book because that's not Paul and Chani's relationship. And in fact, it's like, so he's going to, he wants to have the marriage with, Irulan because as you say, he thinks it will help. Right. And he, says he's going to negotiate. He's going to send his mother to negotiate about it. Okay. Paul, hearing the secret. Okay. So Chani said, he's saying he crossed to them, still looking down at Chani. Does he say, I'll love you forever and then turn away?
In the book? No.
I know the reasons, Chani whispered, if it must be, Usul. Paul, hearing the secret tears in her voice, touched her cheek. My Sihaya need fear nothing ever, he whispered. He dropped his arm, faced his mother. You will negotiate for me, mother, with Chani by your side. She has wisdom and sharp eyes, and it is wisely said that no one bargains tougher than a Fremen. She will be looking through the eyes of her love for me and with the thought of her sons to be what they will need. Listen to her. Wait, who's she going to have sons with? Jessica sensed the harsh calculation her son put down a shutter. What are your instructions? She asked. He says he's going to get the Chum Company as a dowry entire, blah, blah, blah. What are the Fremen? The Fremen are mine. What shall they receive, blah, blah. And for me, Jessica asked, is there something you wish? Perhaps Caladan, she said, looking at Gurney. I'm not certain. I've become too much the Fremen and the Reverend Mother. I need a time of peace and stillness in which to think. That you shall have, Paul said. And anything else that Gurney or I can give you? Jessica nodded, feeling suddenly old and tired. She looked at Chani. And for the royal concubine? No title for me, Chani whispered. Nothing, I beg of you. Paul stared down into her eyes, remembering her suddenly as she had stood once with little Leto in her arms, their child now dead in this violence. They've had a child, which compressing the time frame erases, right? And they go on to have two more children, one of whom is in fact going to become the God Emperor of Dune, right? Chani is the one that has the children, not Irulan. I swear to you now, he whispered, that you'll need no title. That woman over there, Princess Irulan, will be my wife, and you but a concubine, because this is a political thing. We must weld peace out of this moment, enlist the great houses of the Lansrod. We must obey the forms. Yet that princess, this is amazingly, it's like brutal, right? Yet that princess shall have no more of me than my name. Never gonna sleep with her.
What'd she do to you?
No child of mine, nor touch, nor softness of glance, nor instant of desire.
That's marriage and name only.
Literally a name only. So say you now, Chani said. She glanced across the room at the tall princess. Do you know so little of my son, Jessica whispered. See that princess standing there, so haughty and confident? They say she has pretensions of a literary nature. And now you suddenly realize she's been writing the whole thing, right? It's like, right, that's the first clue that you have of the, why Princess Irulan is in writing all those epigraphs. That's all she gets to do. She gets no children. I mean, this is like, whoa. Now, this is intensely more powerful than girl boss going off and getting on her own worm.
Yeah.
Let us hope she finds solace in such things. She'll have little else. A bitter laugh escaped Jessica. Think on it, Chani. That princess will have a name, yet she'll live as less than a concubine, never to know a moment of tenderness from the man to whom she's bound. While we, Chani, we who carry the name of concubine, history will call us wives.
Kind of cruel.
Well, that's like dramatically riveting, don't you think?
It is.
Way more than, I'll love you always. Here, I'm going to go marry this other woman. I mean, It's the brutality of, wait, which one's the wife and which one's the concubine? Which one is the mother of... Jessica was never married to Leto. That being the whole point of her, right? She was the concubine, not the wife. And she's trying, you know, she's telling Chani, you and I are the ones that carry the true lineage, not these wives in name. Mm. Oh my gosh. What kind of story is this?
Story of the Queen of Sheba?
Oh, who knows? There, you're thinking, no, yes, right? Now, I'd say if he's the Messiah and he's got two wives, two women, one on either side of him, what image is this? Please, Herbert. He's got the Ark of the Covenant in there. He must also, therefore, have the church and the synagogue.
Mm.
In name, in actual children. The concubine who has the actual children versus, I mean, it's like, oh my gosh, what did he just do?
Did you think he knew what he did? I don't think so.
No, because this is like, you know, the lever of when we start saying, when the story, you know that this is the right outcome for the story, right? It's like there's power in this dynamic and this tension. And you write it that way and you say, why is that the powerful part? That's because I think it's tapping into a reality that is deeper than I'm being clever with my plot.
Hmm. It kind of also reminded me what you just explained there of Isaac and Ishmael.
Jacob and Esau?
Yeah.
Twinned nations?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
He published this in 1965, the year Vatican II finished, right? There are deep, deep, like, and it's in the desert, and it's which empire is the right one, and who are we, and the twinnings. Yeah. This, as I was thinking about it, getting ready for our talk, it's like it kept like ricocheting. We're not done yet. We aren't even done. Okay, what was the best love scene in the movie? I'm showing it. It wasn't with Paul and Chani.
Best love scene in the movie. The
one that like actually was hot.
Oh, right. Yeah. Babe Ruth. Yeah. Yeah.
He's a better actor. Sorry, guys.
Oh, gosh. Oh. Yeah, he was incredible.
Right?
He was amazing.
And one, it's like, yeah. So Fendring is seducing him so she can have the baby, you know, after testing him with the Gamjabar and, you know, proving he's human. It's like, no, right. It's just the scene, right? So,
yeah.
He wasn't supposed to be with her. Right? Because this is sort of like, he gets his birthday present and she has to seduce him because Jessica has messed up the line.
Yeah, she has to seduce him and have a girl. Yeah.
Right. Right. Because, but it's like, this was not the Fade Routh and Fenring, Margot Fenring, were not the pairing that was supposed to happen. So I wonder what pairing was supposed to happen. What's the second sex?
I don't
What's
know.
What's the second sexiest scene in the movie? Now I'm showing it to you. It's got a sun behind it. Knife. Fight. I mean, one, Butler's a really good actor, so this scene was great. And apparently the guys practiced it a lot. Fights are really sexy. Oh my God.
So I'm trying to think of, what is she talking about? That's why.
I mean, okay. Butler's in both of them. We liked him, right? No eyebrows and everything. His actual hair is very handsome. Who was Fade Routh supposed to marry?
Was he supposed to marry a princess? Mm-hmm. Okay. Right, that's right, because she was talking to her father, so he's a psychopath.
Well, no, he wasn't supposed to marry Irulan, right?
Oh.
I hadn't put all this together, right? He was supposed to marry the girl that was Paul.
Oh, okay. Paul was supposed to be
Paul
a girl.
Paul was supposed to be a girl. Right. Right? And yeah. So you're... That's amazing fight scene at the end. Not just they're cousins and so they're related and stuff. It's like they were supposed to be married because
oh, that's
isn't
freaking
that
weird.
Wild? And you're just like, who wrote this? Oh, right, Herbert wrote this, right?
I'm gonna have to watch this many times more because there's a couple. That's one of the points I missed. It's like you brought up two that I actually settle.
Well, I didn't get them until now, right? It's like, sorry, if you ask me to go for something and I'm gonna analyze it, you're gonna like go deep into like the sandworms go deep, but don't go this deep, right? Humpback whales don't go this deep. It's like the Bene Gesserit that Jessica was supposed to have a girl. Their daughter, Leto and Jessica's daughter, was supposed to marry Fade Routh, and they were going to bring together the houses, right? So,
but they would have been cousins.
Oh, who cares? That's what the Habsburgs did, right? The generations long breeding, although they end up with horrible jaws, right? They end up the generations long breeding programs to make an emperor. Yeah, it's like, so they were going to be, yes, but Fade Routh was supposed to marry the Atreides' daughter, who doesn't exist because Paul is there.
But there is an Atreides' daughter.
Well, by that time, Paul's killed Fade Routh, so it's not going to work. But
yeah,
but it's the, you know, I think the genius of the storytelling and the desire to make meaning, which is, you know, I think ultimately when I say what's religious, right, it's there is meaning to life. And I think the feeling that people are coming out, but the ones people who've liked the movie, they say, my life is different. I've been changed. I've seen this beautiful thing.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I've seen people say that. Yeah, they're quite powerful. And, you know, and then maybe they had the buckets of popcorn with the worm head on them, and it affected them differently than me, but I think at the deepest level, it's the same thing that gets people when they read Tolkien and they don't realize that what they're reading is a fundamentally religious book.
So yeah, it resonates with their soul, but they don't actually know why.
Exactly.
Interesting.
Which is, you know, challenging because, oh, what is Paul there for? This was your last juxtaposition.
Yeah, I like that.
Who is he now? And what are the worms? Mel, it's your turn. You still there? Okay, so you found this one. This is Paul, I think, in a vision, right? And he's wearing...
Yes. Golden armor.
And you were convinced that this was paired with this other image, purposefully. I don't know who's doing the pairing here, but, you know. What is the other image?
Oh, the colors are perfect.
Yeah, the other, what's it showing?
Okay, so it's a picture of Saint Michael wearing golden armor slaying a dragon. So Paul's the avenging angel, at least in his own head, because it's his vision.
Yeah, but come on, the stories work, right? It's like they're in our gut. They're in our you know, they're in our DNA. They're in our, like with the Empire and Rome and the whales and the...
They're in our consciousness.
Yeah.
And yeah, our consciousness is not literally, collective, but it does appear to be that way because it resonates with so many people.
Something.
All these images do.
Well, this is, I say, we on the Mosaic Ark here have a mission. Or a practice, maybe it's a practice. Are we Bene Gesserit? We don't know. To try to unpack the reality of faith in a way that's not about, you know, you must believe this story because it, you know, prophesies things and proves, you know, you can prove it by things coming true. Jesus said not to do that, right? You want signs, you've got plenty of those prophecies that, you know, what are you going to be satisfied by in terms of your heart? And, you know, I think, I mean, Jonathan Peugeot is doing that in his streams on his own terms, right? We are going into these and saying these, they're not just classic stories that echo the Bible. They're true. And Herbert raised Catholic and raised with enough of this. When he went into become a storyteller, it was like, I need to tell this story and wrestling with it is fine. And if he's guided as a writer to the power of the story, it's going to come out this way. Just going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's a fallen world that he's describing. And so they're going to do terrible things to each other, but the, the feeling yes. of tension that he's working with. And that's why I was mad at Villeneuve by the end, because he wrecked it.
Was there one point that wrecked that convinced you he wrecked it?
Yeah, when they said the fundamentalists were in the South.
Oh, why is that?
Because that's tacky. Right? It's like, oh yeah, in the North believe rationally, but the more fundamentalist Fremen, they're all in the South. We'll go South.
Okay, so you're talking about America, like the Deep yeah. South, the Bible Belt. Okay, I get it.
They yeah. caricatured the whole dynamic, which was this layered yeah. tension between the different religions, the Bene Gesserit, the manipulation of the people by the guild, and this incredible, you know, melange of religious beliefs, which Herbert himself is obviously wrestling with.
And it could not just be America. You could apply that to Europe as well, right? You have the rational Protestant North and the superstitious Catholic South.
Again, right?
Yeah.
And
I didn't pick up on that, but I can see that.
Instead of sustaining the tension, making Paul like constantly questioning himself, it's like he is something, right? He is the Kwisatz-Haderach. Something is different about him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he says to his mother, "You made me a freak." Well, yeah, there is something different about him. So even if, their prophecies or stories that are there, it's like, if the story is there to look for the Ark and the Ark shows up, have you been tricked?
Mm. Yeah. Right. And I did catch that too. It's like, well, if they seeded these prophecies everywhere, the result was the same, because he did show up and he does have these powers.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, it's like, you're going to outwit God. You better.
Yeah.
Right.
That'll be amusing to watch.
Good luck with that. Right. So yeah. I think the story in its elements has so many wonderful layers that, in fact, it is in the long run a love story, but it's the different love story. It's the great love story that we're in.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Mel was right that the worms are dragons because they're actually sea monsters and they're like sea monsters. They're Leviathan.
Right. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. And then the very opening scene where Paul is explaining to Chani that, you know, this is all underwater on my home planet. That was like a huge clue right there.
There are sea monsters.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's Leviathan. And therefore it is, in fact, the great monster that Yahweh fights in the Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
So I just, I'd say Herbert was a very bright young man and boy, and probably listened to more lessons than he let on.
Yeah. He absorbed all of it.
And in fact blends, I mean, so everybody's, you know, the articles we saw about it was someone being upset that there's so much, Arabic, which Christians use Arabic too, by the way. That there's so much Arabic mm-hmm. language in it. And, you know, you expect it to be a Muslim or, I mean, it could be Zen, it could be Buddhist, it could be Hindu. He plays with pretending that he's got all, it's a Messiah story. It's Christian.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so the test we have is the degree to which, and I think therefore Fade Routh is interesting because one that Butler played him so well, but, he's Paul's twin too. Like the Harkonnen and Atreides are twinned. All of these twins, right? And there's a lot mm-hmm. of twins, you know, brother stories in the scriptures too.
Yeah.
They were caught in this brother battle.
Yeah, Jacob and Esau.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Tim Smith is saying, too bad rationalism is irrational. Well, indeed. Surprised to get what you were praying for. Rainline, did we just turn the Old Testament into the chicken and egg? Well, our knowledge is tricky, right? It's like revelation is a problem because how, you know, it's like we don't know about the creation of the world, because none of us are here, and the angel told it Moses on the mountain. How do we know what it is? So there is a degree of chicken and egg to our knowledge. And that's actually an interesting problem, because the Bene Gesserit have real spiritual practices that train them truly in ascetic powers and being human. I mean, they're nuns in that sense, right? That they have an actual, like, disciplined life.
Well, there is, and I don't know what it's called, but there is some kind of, oh gosh, I wish I remember the name of this. I should have looked it up. There's a Jesuit contemplative practice meant to help you, I guess, pray.
It's almost the spiritual exercises.
Go ahead. That's it. Thank you. Yeah. So yeah, when they were talking about it, it reminded me of the spiritual exercises of the Jesuits, which I think Saint Ignatius was a soldier, right? Mm-hmm. And he developed this when he was convalescing.
Exactly.
And so yeah, it is very well. Its origins are, I don't know if they're militaristic or the antidote to it, but as expressed by Herbert, they're militaristic.
Well, that's our problem, right? That's our problem in Draco Alchemicus, right? What's the poison and what's the antidote?
Yeah, right.
So we hope we've entertained you. Casey, you and I talked too long.
We did. I just looked at the clock.
Did it feel that long? As long as the movie. We went as long as the movie. Good for us. Are you persuaded by my reading?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm persuaded, but,
are you happy with it? Does it make you unhappy to have the movie unpacked in this way? Or do we want
No, not at all. Okay. Oh, not at all. Because there's two things going on with this movie. There's the story and then there's the experience.
Yes.
Of just watching it. And that's really clear. Yeah.
And I think the experience is where we started, right? But it's like, that is actually the primary point of it. Our McLuhan moment of the media of being in it. Matters.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
The images matter a lot.
And even beyond like the writing on Jessica's face is beyond the story meaning that it has in the script.
Yeah, that was a nice addition.
Okay, so Cain and Abel. Let me see. They've been having a nice, well, it's lots of male dragons and fairy queen, Welsh miners, bagpipes, St. George. Paul and girl Paul. Yeah, that unfortunately, Chani ends up twinned with Paul, which is not great. In Prism thinks Sting was a much more attractive fate. You're wrong.
Yeah, you are wrong. No, we've seen him without the pale albino makeup.
And you're wrong.
You're wrong.
I always felt sorry for Irulan. Yes. She is a tragic figure because she doesn't get to be a mother. She's deprived of her womanhood for nothing because she's the princess, right? Mm-hmm. It's brutal. And that, it's interesting that, you know, girl boss story, you know, girl Paul goes off to get her own worm instead of this horrible tension that are going to be between the two women. That's dramatically much more interesting.
Like Rachel and Leah.
Yes. Like Rachel and Leah. It's much more like Rachel and Leah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like all of these Old Testament twinnings, they're there in the book. Faith is believing that reason exists, yes. Well, so far, on the basis of the chat, we seem to have persuaded them. The language of love. Mel is dropping in poetic raindrops for us throughout the chat. Well, that was fun. That was a lot of fun. I now having convinced myself I want to go see it again, right? Just to listen to the music.
Me too. Yeah. I gotta see it again too.
it makes me feel like we are in this magnificent story, and it's glorious that there's a filmmaker that has visually and orally and at so many. I mean, and the thing is, the cast is very strong. I wasn't convinced by Chani. She wasn't. Yeah, no. But
no, though she and Timothée Chalamet had zero. What's the word I'm looking for? We spoke about this earlier.
Chemistry.
Thank you. I was trying to say charisma, but she doesn't have that either. But yeah, they had no chemistry whatsoever. And that was really because it was supposed to be a love story. Right. And there wasn't a lot of dialogue in that area. It was just pictures of them together a lot with some dialogue, but not anything deep. And so you really needed to have some chemistry between those actors to make up for that. It could have worked, but I don't think it worked with those two actors together.
Well, and then they wrote, but writing Chani's ending wrong really affects it because they have children and they have the twins that in the long history of Dune, her son becomes the God Emperor, right? So it's right. She's, if they bring her, I mean, the outroar and the outcry, and if there's a third movie, right? If they bring her back, that's interesting. But instead of having that incredibly poignant moment where she has to keep him but lose him, and Jessica saying, you know, we are the ones that are the actual mothers behind all of this.
It makes me see what Duke Leto said in the first movie in a different light, because she's putting him to sleep, right, using mind tricks.
Right.
As he's falling asleep, he said, "I should have made you my wife."
Exactly. Exactly.
And I think what he meant was that I can't trust you and I shouldn't be having kids with you.
But no, I think he never honored her with the status that she should have had. Yeah.
That's what I thought. That's what I thought when he said that. But given what you've just read about Jessica explaining to Chani how we're much better than the wives, in light of that, when he says to her, "I should have made you my wife," it seems like he was saying, I'm too close to you and I don't want to be, which is kind of strange, but maybe, yeah, maybe that's nothing.
This sounds like to be continued when we do Bridgerton one day. We'll get there one day. I'm still reading the novels and oh my gosh, the sex scenes in those. Woohoo. All right. So thank you all for joining us. Please join us on Unauthorized so that you can participate in the chat and help us see whether we're keeping on track or not. Please, the subscriptions help us greatly with our artwork, particularly our illustrations for Draco Alchemicus, which Act 2 is written and we are plotting the images now. So, you know, keep us going. Like and subscribe if you're watching on YouTube and follow me in Telegram for hints at what may be coming next. Anyway, thank you all. Thanks for joining us. Good night.